Super Metroid was a mega hit for the Metroid series and cemented the franchise as a landmark for atmosphere, level design, iconic soundtracks, and fun gameplay. But with such an ambitious and strong entry into the series, how does one follow up such a classic? The answer? A highly conceptually designed horror-esque game titled Metroid Fusion to co-release with the groundbreaking GameCube masterpiece Metroid Prime. These games were both solid entries into the franchise that kept fans fed while the series continued to go into a bit of a renaissance. Metroid Prime definitely was the more analyzed and praised out of the two though, with me often not hearing much discussion about the fourth entry into the 2D part of this franchise until recently. I don't think this is very fair, as I find a lot of the quality of life changes and control improvements in Fusion to be some of the most refined and best in the entire series, with a lot of iconic and fantastic story elements, with a lot of these elements seemingly having to have a huge impact on the upcoming Metroid Dread game. I'm super excited to cover this game, and I have a lot of love for this specific entry in the franchise. What exactly makes Metroid Fusion one of my favorites and the most underrated 2D Metroidvanias in the series? Let's find out. I am Sleep, and welcome to Metroid Fusion. Following the end of Super Metroid and the destruction of Zebes, Samus gets hired to assist the Galactic Federation explore SRG-388, likely due to her knowledge of the area from the Metroid 2 games. After attacking a common enemy, suddenly she's attacked by this blob cell-like creature that infects her. Samus, like the 100 IQ person she is, decides to just walk it off like it's nothing, but suddenly, mid-flight on a mission, Samus's nervous system shuts down, making her lose consciousness and drift into an asteroid field, destroying her iconic gunship. Here, an unconscious Samus is recovered through an auto-eject pod on her ship by the Galactic Federation, where they attempt to stop the virus. At this point, though, the virus is so spread through her system that it's made parts of her power suit not removable. They surgically remove what they can, but her appearance is dramatically changed. This isn't enough though, and Samus is put into a near-death situation. This is when the surgeons are approached by scientists who bring up the idea to inject Samus with Metroid DNA extracted from the baby Metroid in a possible attempt to stop the virus. To their surprise, Samus recovers almost immediately, and Samus for the second time is saved by the baby Metroid. Samus, now part Metroid, wakes up and heads out to the Federation station, where she picks up a distress call from the nearby BSL research station. This time though, instead of heading out into this journey confident, Samus is now at her most vulnerable and weakest. This fusion of her and the baby Metroid have now put her into a state of fear and dread. Landing on the station with the ship given to her by the Federation, Samus this time is being assisted by a Federation AI thanks to the confidentiality of the research here and her fragile state. She compares the situation with the AI to another time when she had to follow the commands of a commanding officer named Adam Malkovich in the past, thus giving it the name Adam in secret. Through the rest of this game, you'll be told where to go and what to do through this AI. This in tandem with the more linear and point-by-point level design of Fusion makes this game probably one of the most divisive and controversial games in the series. Let's talk about this game's approach to level design and the way you progress through this labyrinth of a research station. Aside from the intro of most Metroid games, a lot of what's being conveyed to you when it comes to story or where you're supposed to go is through subtext. It's a show-not-tell kind of mindset the series has consistently been praised for, and they could have easily just went for this kind of approach with the knowledge from what they've learned through Super Metroid, but they didn't. This game is ambitious and weird in terms of a Metroidvania. This game wants to take risks and tell a lot more of a cohesive and in-depth narrative with dialogue telling you where to go. But does this betray the Metroidvania genre? Isn't this the complete antithesis of what makes Metroid a fantastic series? How could people out there praise a game so linear in design like this? Well, the game especially excels in an aspect of Metroid many of us take for granted. This is the atmosphere and feeling of dread established pretty early into the game. You see, there's this force that is consistently hunting you throughout the game, possibly at every corner, waiting to throw you into a tense and climactic chase scene akin to something straight out of the Resident Evil franchise. This force being an ex-parasite clone of our protagonist Samus Aran at the peak of her strength from the end of Super Metroid. You see, the ex-parasites are almost completely indestructible gooey cell-like creatures that kill and mimic their prey, often morphing into distorted and horrific versions of the creatures they killed once damaged. With this horrific clone of herself that is armed in a way that can completely destroy her in mere seconds, Samus takes it upon herself for the rest of the game to arm herself and become stronger through exploration in an attempt to eradicate this possible galactic threat. This means you'll go through various sectors that will try to replicate different environments from SR-388, with the possibility of being absolutely brutalized in a chase sequence by a horrifying clone of yourself. These moments are tough and usually take multiple attempts to get the pattern of the SAX down when it comes to where it's exploring in the area so that you can get through these areas in a clutch escape. It's a subversion of expectations that feels risky and engaging. This happens a lot with a general gameplay loop too. The game wants you to believe it's a lot more linear than it is too, but sometimes when Adam gives you orders, something will go terribly wrong or you'll find the path to a goal through means that feel almost non-intentional, but they are. A lot like how this game breaks the boundaries of what makes a Metroidvania, this game also breaks boundaries in terms of rules it wants you to believe it's set in fantastic and cinematic ways. Take for example this famous scene where after completing some missions, the game has you head back to the upper central area of the station, only to have the elevator break down and have you explore an area with absolutely no help from Adam, causing the AI to get pissed when you come back significantly more equipped than what it expected you to be. Samus, a lot like the level in game design, rebels against the restraints of the AI and empowers the player in a way. She makes her own path and overcomes obstacles horrifying in nature through holes in such a clean and precise plan. This leads you to some of the most iconic and horrific parts of this game, with some terrifying bosses and discoveries when it comes to the environment. Take for example when the game completely goes off the rails with a lack of handholding when it comes to going into the depths of the station through holes built into the level design by a creature being built up through the entirety of the frozen and cold Sector 5 after an intimidating and shadowy escape. The tension and world building for your singular creature pays off with a strange and horrific battle with the Nightmare Boss, which is this rogue AI machine that once far enough into the fight, exposes its true and horrifically disgusting face while you plow your entire arsenal into it. The creature distorts gravity and has this off-putting battle theme that weirds you out and makes you feel uneasy through the entire fight. There are plenty of bosses with well-established build-ups throughout this entire game too. Take for example with the fight with the ex-parasite version of Ceres, a snake-like creature that goes into immense speeds. The game pulls the subversion of expectations with this creature by establishing that it's already dead and is no longer a force to worry about, only to hit you with the battle with said creature only a few moments following the discovery of its corpse. There's the iconic fight with the mutated and disgusting Ridley, whose corpse is shown early on if you decide to venture into a cold room without the proper equipment, only for you to later watch as said corpse has its DNA copied by an ex, leading you to a fight with the creature in a very traditional but visually disgusting fight with a monster. All these different moments build up to probably one of the most intriguing and fantastic final acts of a Metroid game, with you, after defeating a pesky security drone infected by an ex, unlock access via wavebeam to a top secret Federation sector of the station, where it's revealed that the Galactic Federation plans to use hyper-evolved Metroids as a possible bioweapon leading into the future. Suddenly, in the middle of Samus's revelation, she's interrupted by the SAX, causing her to make a great escape and ejecting the entire Metroid cloning lab along with the SAX from the station, having it crash and destroyed on the surface of SR388. This absolutely pisses off Adam, and when he gets in an argument with Samus, this causes her to completely question the intentions of the Galactic Federation and really breaking her trust with them. Adam spills information to Samus about the research on both the Metroids and the ex-parasites, dropping the bombshell that there are dozens of SAXs on board with the Federation on their way to contain and use them. Samus protests against this plan, pointing out the potential for things to go absolutely horribly and demands Adam to let her out of this briefing room. The robot declines her demands until she lets the Adam name slip and explains the backstory between her somewhat messy relationship with the late Adam Malkovich. Suddenly, as if the AI flips a switch, it suddenly starts commanding Samus to head to the top of the station and crashing it into SR388 in an attempt to stop the Federation's plan, ending the briefing by calling her Lady. This hints to Samus and the player that this AI might have had some kind of consciousness or memories of her old commanding officer and gives Samus an emotional connection to this machine. With the mission clear as day and the AI letting her go, Samus heads to the operation room atop the station to send it into a collision course with SR388. On her way to the operations room though, Samus is confronted with an SAX and forces her to face it in one final battle. This boss throws his entire arsenal at you, forcing you to outmaneuver and defeat the boss with superior planning and skill. It's a fantastic send-off to this horrific force and feels similar to when you get to fight the tyrants or bosses in a Resident Evil game that have caused you up to hours of stress through tense scenes and a satisfying boss fight. The SAX mid-fight, a lot like the Resident Evil villains, morph into a disgusting mutated version of its once cloned form and hits a lot harder. Once you prevail through this fight though, the parasite goes back into its blobby form and retreats as you move forward and activate the self-destruct sequence. A lot like the classic Metroid games, you make your way down the beginning of the game through a tense and scary countdown sequence, but with it weirdly enough giving you a lot more time than needed. You start to realize why though, as you suddenly don't find your ship in its original spot and are attacked by an Omega Metroid. You get absolutely slapped around by this thing and can't even land any decent hits on it. This is when suddenly the SAX you defeated appears and tries laying into the Omega Metroid with similar results. After being defeated, it gains back its gel-like form and you absorb it, gaining back most of your lost abilities. Just like with the Hyper Beam and Mother Brain in Super Metroid, you absolutely lay into the boss and obliterate the motherfucker, thus overcoming your last obstacle. Your ship mysteriously autopilots back to its original spot and you leave the station in your ship right on time. Here, Adam reveals that with the help of some familiar animals that you save earlier into the game, the ship was piloted to not be harmed by the Omega Metroid so that Samus could escape. Here, Samus blasts off into distant space with her now being accompanied by Adam and the animals, thus ending the game. Overall, Metroid Fusion is probably one of my favorite Metroid games, period, with me having a lot of new appreciation for the risk it takes and the boundaries it breaks for the Metroid franchise. This game is one I think deserves a lot more praise than it gets, and is one that feels overlooked compared to the others. It's one I hold very dear to me, and it's one I'm happy to see referenced in future titles in the series like Metroid Dread. But we'll have to talk about that game another time. Thank you guys for hopping on by for another review of mine. I am Sleep, and I hope to see you again. See ya!